Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on a COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Presiding Officer, in giving an update on the latest COVID situation, I'll provide an assessment of the current course of the pandemic. In light of that, I'll confirm that no immediate changes are being proposed to the mitigations that remain in place. I'll also report on the progress of the vaccination programme and provide a brief update on international travel, and lastly, give a summary of the mitigations that are being deployed to minimise the risks of transmission at or around COP26. First, though, the most recent statistics, 2,262 positive cases were reported yesterday, 11.5% of all tests conducted. 917 people are currently in hospital with COVID, 15 more than yesterday. 59 people are receiving intensive care, 2 more than yesterday. And sadly, a further 20 deaths have been reported over the past 24 hours. That takes the total number of deaths registered under this daily definition to 9,072. Once again, I want to send my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one. More positively, the vaccination programme continues to make good progress, and I'll provide more details on the booster programme later. However, at this stage, I will confirm that 4,309,932 people have received a first dose, 3,897,133 have had both doses. In total, 87% of the over 18 population is now fully vaccinated with 2 doses. This includes 96% of the over 40s, 76% of 30 to 39-year-olds and 67% of 18 to 29-year-olds. In addition, 75% of 16 and 17-year-olds and 53% of 12 to 15-year-olds have had a first dose, and of course, for most people in these age groups, only a single dose is recommended at this stage. This weekly update coincides with the latest 3-week review point for the remaining regulations, and so I can confirm, as indicated a moment ago, that at our meeting today, the Cabinet agreed to make no change to the current regulations that are in place. This reflects our assessment that, although the situation has greatly improved since August, it does remain fragile as we head into the winter period. In my statement before the recess, I reported that case numbers had fallen by more than 20% in the preceding week and by more than 60% in the preceding 5 weeks. The fact that cases had declined so steeply without the need for tougher restrictions was extremely welcome. It showed that increased compliance with mitigations, together with increased immunity through vaccination, previous infections, or in some cases both, had been capable of stemming even the Delta variant. However, over the past 3 weeks, while cases remain much lower than the previous peak, the decline has levelled off. Indeed, in recent days, we've been reporting a very slight increase in cases. To illustrate that further, 3 weeks ago, there was, on average, just under 2,500 new cases being reported each day. Now, the average is just over 2,500 cases a day. It is, of course, important to see this in a wider context. Having had the highest rate for a period, Scotland currently has the lowest COVID case rate of the 4 UK nations. And the increase in cases is, at this stage, relatively small, around 2%. We're certainly not experiencing a surge in new cases of anything like the magnitude of late August. However, as we know from experience, there is never any room for complacency with this virus. We can't ignore the fact that case numbers have started to creep up again. And of course, even before this recent increase, they were at a level higher than we would have wanted. One consequence of the continued high number of cases is that the NHS remains under significant pressure. Indeed, although case numbers are lower than in early September, we are seeing a slightly different age distribution with increases in the older rather than the younger populations. That, in part, helps to explain why the steep reduction in case numbers has not been mirrored by an equally steep decline in hospital admissions. COVID-related hospital occupancy, which is the number of patients in hospital with COVID at any given time, is lower than it was 3 weeks ago, 917 today compared to 998 3 weeks ago, but it has increased slightly again in the past week. Hospital admissions also remain high. There are more than 600 people with COVID still being admitted each week just now, and admissions to ICU have also increased. So what all of this means is that NHS staff are dealing with significant numbers of COVID patients alongside other patient care, while also preparing for wider winter pressures and dealing with the backlog of care built up in earlier stages of the pandemic. In fact, the entire health and care system is currently under considerable pressure, as all members are aware, arguably more pressure now than at any previous stage of the pandemic. Across the country, hospitals are at or close to capacity, and the social care system is also under pressure. These pressures are, of course, likely to intensify during the winter period. We know that with people meeting indoors more often during winter, there are more opportunities for a virus to circulate, and that could lead to a further rise in cases. We're also approaching the winter flu season, which could also add to the pressure on the NHS. We are therefore working closely with health boards as they deal with these pressures, and of course the Health Secretary has already confirmed a package of winter support. In addition, I can confirm today that a further £482 million is being allocated to the NHS and to integration authorities. This includes more than £120 million to support Test and Protect, more than £130 million also to support further the vaccination programme. The balance of funding will cover additional COVID-related costs such as staffing and equipment. The pressures on the NHS are a reminder that COVID is still a threat to our individual health and also to the capacity of our health and care services. This is why continued high compliance with existing mitigations and protections is so vitally important. At this moment of fragility, therefore, I'm asking all of us across the country to make a renewed individual and collective effort to stick to the basic protections that are still in place and help drive cases down again. Please wear face coverings when required, ventilate indoor spaces wherever possible, wash hands and surfaces, use LFD tests regularly, and book a PCR test if one of these LFD tests shows up positive, or if you have symptoms of COVID, or if you are identified as a close contact of someone who is positive. Please also continue to give contact details when visiting pubs and restaurants, for example, and show your COVID certificate if visiting a venue where this is required. The COVID certification scheme has been operational now for more than 3 weeks and is now enforceable by law, and I'm grateful to the businesses who have worked hard to comply with the scheme. And last but not least, we continue to ask people to work from home whenever that is possible, and this does continue to be an important way of reducing transmission. The Scottish Government will continue to work with business to support an appropriate phased return to office working, but it is important to stress that at this stage, we're still encouraging people to work from home as much as possible. And I'm grateful to employers who continue to do everything possible to provide safe environments for both their workers and their customers. Presiding Officer, in summary, this is a moment again for all of us to step up our compliance with these basic protections. We do know from experience that if we do so and when we do so, we can stem transmission, and it is important that we do so now. The judgment of the Cabinet today, informed of course and as always by clinical advice, is that it is not necessary at this stage to reintroduce any tighter restrictions. However, as has always been the case, we will keep this under review. In particular, we will consider on an ongoing basis whether any of the existing mitigations need to be strengthened in any way. Of course, the most important tool we have against COVID is vaccination. The NHS is currently delivering the biggest ever winter vaccination programme. Over the course of this winter, more than 4 million flu vaccines and more than 3 million COVID vaccines will be administered. Almost 1.5 million of these have been delivered already. The COVID booster programme commenced within a week of the JCVI advice on prioritisation being received, and so far more than 500,000 people have had a booster jab. Those over 70 and those on the highest risk list are being prioritised first, and these groups, together with older people in care homes and frontline health and care workers, will all be offered the booster vaccination between now and early November. Other groups, including all adults over the age of 50, will get booster appointments through November, December and in some cases into early January. The portal that will allow those in younger age groups to book appointments online will open in November. I would remind members that the main constraint on the speed of vaccination is the JCVI advice that 6 months must have elapsed between a second dose and a booster dose. So in short, we are making good progress, but every effort is being made and will continue to be made within the limits of that JCVI advice to accelerate at the pace of this programme. For example, particularly as the programme moves down the age groups, we will be considering additional clinics, particularly at evenings and weekends, and we will continue to support health boards to identify, recruit and train additional staff as required. We are also enabling boards to make use of healthcare students and primary care staff, including GPs, GP practice staff, dentists and pharmacists, where this is appropriate to help meet demand. It's also important to note that for convenience and to avoid older and more vulnerable people in particular requiring two separate appointments, COVID booster and flu vaccinations are being co-administered wherever that is possible. Now, this may mean that some people will receive their flu vaccine slightly later this year than might normally be the case. However, please be assured that the timing of flu vaccines is entirely clinically appropriate. Now, I mentioned earlier that 53% of 12 to 15-year-olds have now received their first jab, and I want to sincerely thank all of those young people who have come forward for vaccination. I can confirm that everyone in that age group has now had an appointment scheduled and should have received a letter telling them about their appointment. And I would again encourage all 12 to 15-year-olds not already vaccinated and their parents and carers to read the online information about vaccination so that they can take an informed decision about getting the jab. And if you haven't come forward yet, please do so as soon as possible. As I noted earlier, the scale of the winter vaccination programme currently underway is unprecedented. And I therefore want to take the opportunity today to say how grateful I am, how grateful all of us in the government, and I'm sure across the chamber are, to all of those across our pressurised health and care service who are contributing to the success of the vaccination programme. And again, I would urge everyone to get vaccinated for flu, for COVID or for both if you are eligible, as soon as you are called to do so. Getting vaccinated remains the single most important thing we can all do to protect ourselves, particularly over the course of this winter, and of course to protect each other. The good progress in vaccinating young people is relevant to the next issue I want to briefly refer to, which is our ongoing work to ensure that schools remain as safe in this context as possible. We confirmed last week that the current school mitigations, including the wearing of face coverings, would remain in place for a further period. This is in light of the slight increase that we have seen and I've reported on today in transmission of the virus. However, we also gave a commitment to monitor key information, including, of course, case rates on a weekly basis, and lift these mitigation measures in schools as soon as it is considered prudent to do so. We also know that ventilation is one of the most important ways to reduce the risk of airborne COVID transmission and that carbon dioxide monitors can help schools assess and improve their ventilation. That's why we committed to provide local authorities with an additional £10 million of funding to ensure that schools and childcare settings have access to carbon dioxide monitoring. I can confirm that the Education Secretary will be writing to the Education Committee of Parliament later this week with a full update on the progress local authorities have made in completing CO2 assessments of schools and other education facilities. Presiding Officer, there are two other issues I want to touch on before concluding today. The first relates to rules on international travel. Fully vaccinated travellers returning from non-red list countries are currently required to take a PCR test on day two of their arrival back to or into Scotland. The UK government announced recently that travellers arriving into England will be able to take a lateral flow test with photo verification instead of a PCR test. For practical reasons, the Scottish Government will align with this change. That means from 4 a.m. on Sunday, 31st October, people travelling to Scotland can also provide a lateral flow test rather than a PCR test on day two of their arrival. Travellers will be able to book lateral flow tests from the list of providers on the gov.uk site in advance of arrival into Scotland from around 5 p.m. on Friday. These tests cost between £20 and £30, which is less than a PCR test, so I am sure this change will be welcomed by travellers and by the travel industry. However, it is important to stress that if a lateral flow test is positive, a PCR test must then be booked to confirm the result. The final update I want to give today relates to the upcoming COP26 summit in Glasgow, which of course gets underway this coming weekend. Indeed, some delegates are already here for pre-sessional events. The summit, of course, is one of the most important gatherings of this century so far. It is perhaps the world's last chance to avert future climate catastrophe. The Scottish Government will do everything we can, working with the UK Government, to help make it a success. The hosting of COP would always have been a significant challenge given the scale of the event for the UK and Scottish governments and for Glasgow City Council. However, the fact that it is happening amidst a global pandemic obviously makes it even more challenging. And it is inevitably the case that an event of this scale poses a risk of increased COVID transmission. However, I want to assure Parliament and the public that the Scottish Government has been working closely with the United Nations and the UK Government to mitigate these risks as far as possible. Steps have been taken to ensure, as far as possible, that delegates have been fully vaccinated before arrival. Everyone arriving in Glasgow from outside the common travel area will also need to show a negative test result before they arrive in the UK. And anyone from the seven countries still on the travel red list will be required to stay in managed quarantine for 10 days. In addition, everyone entering the core venues for COP, the Blue Zone, will be required to take a lateral flow COVID test every day, wear face coverings and follow 1 metre physical distancing and hand hygiene guidance. The event space also has strict hygiene protocols in place. And of course, all of those attending, whether they are attending as official delegates or activists, will be required to follow the same basic COVID precautions as the rest of the population, such as wearing face masks in indoor public places and in public transport. As we know, all of these steps will help reduce the risk of COVID transmission, and I hope they help make COP a safe event, as well as, we all hope, a successful event. Presiding Officer, I said earlier that our position, although improved from over the summer, is still fragile. Vaccination is still allowing us to live with far, far fewer restrictions and mitigations than was possible at earlier stages of the pandemic. And, of course, case numbers are lower than they were in August and early September. But they are still high and may now be rising again. And as I have already mentioned today, please do get vaccinated if you are eligible and haven't yet done so. That includes going for a booster jab when you're invited to do so. It is never too late to get vaccinated, so if you haven't done so previously, it is still possible now to come forward and get your jags. Second, please test regularly with lateral flow devices. I remind people that these can be ordered through NHS Inform or collected from local test sites or pharmacies. If you test positive or are identified as a close contact or have symptoms, please self-isolate and book a PCR test. And thirdly, please comply with the mitigations that are still in place. Wear face coverings in indoor public places, wash hands and surfaces thoroughly. Meet outdoors if you can. That is increasingly difficult as we get deeper into winter, but outdoor environments are safer. When meeting indoors, open windows, anything at all that improves ventilation will help. All of these precautions do make a difference. We've seen that at previous stages of this pandemic. They will protect you and the people around you, and they will help ease the burden on our National Health Service. So please stick with it, and my thanks once again to everyone who is doing all of that.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move to the next item of business. I'd ask members to please press their button if they wish to ask a question, and I call on Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Figures released today confirm that we have the worst accident and emergency waiting times ever. every week, just when we think they can't possibly get worse, they do. And it's not only in A&E. Every part of Scotland's frontline health services are stretched to breaking point. Crucially, every one of those numbers represents a patient waiting far too long, sometimes in great pain. Our NHS staff are doing outstanding work and their very best, but they need more support from this government. We welcome the announcement of extra NHS funds, but the problem is this government has repeatedly failed to properly plan ahead and heed the warning signs. This government has dithered and delayed instead of acting. And nowhere, nowhere has that been more apparent than in the rollout of the vaccine booster jab. As the First Minister said, the vaccine is our biggest weapon against this virus. Back in January, when the COVID vaccine was first rolled out, there was real urgency to deliver it. But where is that urgency now? In her statement, the First Minister said the main constraint of rolling out the vaccine is the JCVI advice to wait 6 months between the second jab and the booster jab. But today we learned there are 100,000 people who got their second jab 6 months ago and should be getting their booster, but are still waiting. Has the First Minister identified specifically what is holding up those people getting their booster jab? Also today, we heard that despite calling for armed forces assistance a week ago, NHS Grampian are still waiting. And it's unclear if the Scottish Government have made that request to the Ministry of Defence. Will the First Minister update Parliament on that request and this issue? I know she's getting it would be useful for the Parliament to get that update today. Finally, we've all heard from constituents, including some very vulnerable people, who have been sent considerable distances to get their flu jab and COVID booster. So can I ask the First Minister, do we have enough vaccination clinics right now to make sure everyone across Scotland can get their injections locally? Thank you.
First Minister.
I'll try to address all of these points. Firstly, on the pressure that our National Health Service is operating under, including our accident and emergency services, it is pressure that is unprecedented, not just here in Scotland, but across the UK. And indeed, health services are facing this pressure across much of the world because of the circumstances of the global pandemic that we have been living through. This government continues through resources and through support in a range of other ways to support the health service as much as we possibly can, and that will continue. The pressure on our health services is undeniable, and that pressure is felt first and foremost by those working on the front line, and my gratitude to them is well known, and I will repeat it again today. But that support means, and this does not in any way take away from the reality of the pressure, but to give some context, accident and emergency services, for example, in Scotland are performing to a higher standard than in the other four nations of the UK. We want to get it higher, but I think it is important that we understand that context. So through the measures that the Health Secretary has outlined, through the further support that I've outlined today, we will continue day and daily to make sure that the health service has the support that it needs. Of course, we can all help the NHS right now by doing all of the things that we know keep downward pressure on COVID. The fewer people in our population who have COVID, the fewer people who will need hospital treatment for COVID, and therefore the more we will all be helping the National Health Service. On vaccination, the vaccination programme in Scotland is going exceptionally well, and I want to just share some of that in more detail briefly with the Chamber. We have, as a percentage of our total population, the highest percentage of people vaccinated, for example, with a first dose of all of the countries of the UK, 78.8% of the total population. The next is Wales with 76.4%. Similarly, in terms of the second dose, 71.2% of the total population in Scotland. Next is Wales again with 70.6%. So we're top of that table. We are also significantly ahead when it comes to the vaccination of 12 to 15-year-olds. On the rollout of booster jabs, which is the single most important thing we are focused on right now, our vaccination rates are broadly in line with the rest of the UK. And as I said, we are doing everything we can to accelerate that within the confines of the JCVI advice. I heard the WHO special envoy on COVID on the radio this morning, recognising the logistical issues that all countries have to grapple with in delivering a vaccination programme of this scale. But everything is being done to make sure that happens at pace. And lastly, Presiding Officer, two points. Firstly, penultimately, because it's also on vaccines. All along in this vaccination programme, we have had to balance local delivery with large-scale delivery, which leads to some people having to travel longer distances. For the older and more vulnerable members of our population, we have tried to do that as locally as possible, and that will continue. We will continue to assess on an ongoing basis the number and location of vaccination clinics to make sure that balance is right. And finally, on the issue of the request for military support by Grampian, that will be submitted when that request has been refined to an appropriate degree. It's important that health boards do not request things that they don't need and make sure that those requests are properly framed. And that work is ongoing.
Thank you. Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My thoughts are firstly with all those who have lost a loved one. When the first wave of this pandemic hit, thousands of our older people and the most vulnerable were put in danger, particularly in our care homes. And the First Minister assured this chamber that lessons would be learned. I note what the First Minister says about NHS pressures, and I accept that COVID is a part of that. But let's not deny the fact that there were huge pressures in our NHS pre-COVID, and our NHS staff were crying out that they were overworked, undervalued and under-resourced even before this pandemic hit. So we are facing those pressures even before the winter has begun, and we're also seeing thousands of older and vulnerable people whose protection is reducing from this pandemic too. Because protection from COVID does decrease over time, and the scientific advice is clear. The booster vaccine should be delivered after 6 months of the second dose. The government is claiming that the booster programme is on track, but today we learnt that up to 104,000 people who are at higher risk from COVID-19 are still waiting for a booster, having already waited longer than 6 months. We're hearing about long queues outside vaccination centres in all weathers, with people being asked to travel many miles for their booster. Some examples. In Alexandria, 79-year-old Janet Finlay waited over 2 hours before being turned away due to her vaccines being recorded incorrectly. Mrs. Christine Howick, 81-year-old, had an appointment at 4 p.m. and had to wait for 2 hours. And Mr. MacDonald, 79-year-old and disabled, had to wait almost an hour and a half. First Minister, that is simply not good enough. These are not figures on a spreadsheet. These are people, people's mothers, people's fathers and people's grandparents. So the First Minister suggested that evening and weekend clinics may open in the future, but does she not agree we need more capacity right now? She has set out that the government's timeline for when boosters will be delivered, but can she tell the 104,000 people who have already waited far too long when they expect to get their boosters? And I'm a bit puzzled and confused by what she said about NHS, Grampian and the use of refined and whether they actually need it or not. The simple fact is this. NHS Grampian has asked the Scottish Government for additional support and military assistance. And over a week later, the MOD has not received that request. We need urgent action for those NHS boards so we can actually deliver quality NHS care for people.
First Minister.
Firstly, nobody denies there was pressure on our NHS pre-COVID. That's why the Scottish Government had already introduced and was progressing well with, for example, a waiting times improvement plan. But equally, nobody, not least anybody who wants to have credibility on these issues, can deny that that pressure has been significantly exacerbated by a global pandemic. On the issue of care homes, We are prioritising vaccination now, as we did at the start of the vaccination programme, for those elderly people in care homes. We were criticised at the start of the vaccination programme for doing so because it made it look as if we were slower in our progress overall, but that was the right decision then and it is the right decision now. We could not start vaccinating with booster jags until the JCVI gave their final advice, by which time many people had already passed the six-month mark. We are making sure that that pace is as fast as it can be and looking at always speed that up, but the six-month rule is there. We are taking a slightly different interpretation of 6 months, actually, to I think the Health Service in England, where we are defining it as 24 weeks rather than 26 weeks to allow us to do it that bit quicker. So we will continue to speed that up as much as possible. We look on an ongoing basis. I had a session with the Health Secretary and officials yesterday to look at what more we can do now and what more we need to do as we go into the lower age groups to make this as quick as possible. And all governments across the UK are grappling with this and following, not identical approaches, but broadly the same approaches. Overall, our vaccination programme has gone well. I've already cited the figures that show how well it is going, but we are focusing on this on a daily basis. We also want to make sure we support health boards to avoid queues or delays when people turn up for vaccination. It will always be a difficult balance to strike between local access and mass access, a difficult balance to strike between appointments and drop-in. That's something that is reviewed again by those administering the programme on a daily basis. This vaccination programme is a success, but the next phase of it remains absolutely critical to getting through the winter. Nothing that the government is doing right now is more important than this. Finally, Presiding Officer, because I can see you looking at me with that gaze, that on the Grampian, it is often the MOD, rightly and understandably, that asks for these requests to be refined. It's important that we make use of military assistance where that is appropriate, but that we don't ask the military to do things that health boards should be doing themselves, and that's why that process is so important.
I call Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On the 20th of September, the Government announced that all adults over the age of 50 would be able to book a booster through the portal in October. Yet October arrived and the Government quietly slid the opening of the portal to mid-November. Such a delay will cause anxiety to those who may be coming hard up against the six-month recommendation. And the First Minister has today called on the public to step up compliance with basic protection. But the government have a duty to step up their efforts to get the basics right as well. Why do they keep missing their own timetables? Why are elderly people without transport being sent to vaccine hubs many miles away, some of whom have vaccine centres on their own doorstep? And why are people still being turned away from appointments due to inaccurate record keeping?
First Minister.
Well, we do these things in a way that we judge to be the quickest and most effective. I remember just a few weeks ago being questioned rightly about why we weren't using schools for the 12 to 15 year old as the first option in terms of vaccination of that age group, and we explained then why, and as it turns out, that has allowed us to vaccinate 12 to 15 year olds more quickly. On the specific questions here, we judged that for the over 70s, rather than open a portal so that they could book online, it was quicker to letter these people and then allow the portal to come in later for the over 50s. If you take, you know, I'm in the over 50 population, I can't get my booster jag right now because there hasn't been a 6 month period yet since my second dose. So the fact that I have to wait into November to book my appointment makes no practical difference to me right now. So we're seeking to do it in the most effective and the most efficient way. I understand the difficulties that trying to get that balance between local access and mass access will strike for people, which is why for the older and frailer age groups, we are using a different approach to the younger age groups. This a system of this scale will always have tensions and difficulties within it. I accept that, and we work to try to resolve those as much as possible. But overall, this vaccination programme is an outstanding success. And that, of course, is because of the efforts of the many people who are delivering it across the country.
I call Fiona Hislop to be followed by Oliver Mundell.
The First Minister may be aware that West Lothian-based vaccine producer Valneva published successful phase 3 trial information recently and are proceeding to seek MHRA and EMA approval. As the UN has indicated that the pandemic may last some time requiring additional COVID vaccines globally, should the Valneva vaccine receive final MHRA EMA approval, can the First Minister commit the Scottish Government to constructively support the company in its export activity and work with the UK to reassess its decision on future ordering policy should future rounds of vaccination and boosters be needed, and to support this Scottish-based manufacturing outlet to provide sustainability of vaccines at home, as well as support global efforts to protect against the pandemic? And what contact, if any, has the Scottish Government had with the company and the UK Government since the Phase 3 trial news?
First Minister.
We'll continue to have appropriate contact with both the company and the UK Government. I know the Health Secretary has had a discussion with Fiona Hislop as well. At present, the UK Vaccines Task Force is procuring vaccines on behalf of all 4 nations, and vaccine supply is secure for the programme that is currently underway. Obviously, we await further scientific and clinical advice on future programmes. However, I do welcome the positive Phase 3 results that Valneva has reported and congratulate the company on those. Scottish Enterprise will continue to support the company as they develop their growth plans in light of the successful clinical trials, and the Scottish Government, of course, will continue to keep all options open as we progress into further phases of this vaccination programme.
Oliver Mundell, to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On 8 October, draft guidance was circulated by the Scottish Government to stakeholders on future plans for the wearing of face coverings in schools. It said that learners in secondary schools will no longer be required to wear face coverings in class, although they will still be required in communal areas. However, when the finalised guidance was published just over a week later, this text had disappeared. Can the First Minister help parents, pupils, teachers, understand what led the Scottish Government to overturn the contents of its own draft guidance? And does the First Minister accept that the indefinite use of face masks in classrooms is not proportionate? And will she set out what the specific conditions that would be required before the Scottish Government would implement its own draft guidance of 8 October. Sorry.
First Minister.
Well, firstly, I think most parents and young people, although I absolutely recognise that many of them do not like a situation where face coverings have to be worn in classrooms, nevertheless understand the reasons. It is not the case, and it is a mischaracterisation of the position to say that the wearing of face coverings is indefinite. We don't want that to be in place for longer than is necessary, but while it is necessary, it is an important protection. I said in my statement that we are now monitoring the case numbers and other relevant information on a weekly basis. In terms of why the position changed, at the start of October, informed by the Education Advisory Subgroup, the draft guidance was put together in the way that the member has cited. Of course, back then cases were declining. Since then, as I have set out fully today, cases have been plateauing and now have started to increase slightly again. And it's in light of that that we considered this further with the full input of the Chief Medical Officer, and it was considered an appropriate and precautionary measure to keep these mitigations in place right now. But we will consider the situation on an ongoing weekly basis, and as soon as it is considered prudent to do so, these mitigations will be removed. And I think everybody would agree that one of the first mitigations, when it's safe to do this, that we would want to see removed is the requirement for young people to wear face coverings in classrooms.
Evelyn Tweed, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland's vaccination certification scheme remains an important tool in helping control the spread of COVID-19. What assurances can the Scottish Government provide to civil liberty and human rights groups who remain understandably cautious of such public health measures?
First Minister.
Well, can I thank Evelyn Tweed for that question? The COVID certification scheme is, in our view, a necessary, proportionate and a limited measure that is targeted towards activities that are higher risk. And it is, and I think this is the important point to remember, an alternative to the potential closure of higher risk venues. All of our decisions are taken and reviewed on the latest data and clinical evidence. The review process includes consideration of impact assessments such as equality impact assessments and children's rights and wellbeing impact assessments, and that I think should be an important assurance to civil liberties and human rights groups. We will not keep this scheme or any other COVID mitigation measure in place any longer than is necessary, but right now it is an important protection and one that I think for the foreseeable future will continue to be an important mitigation.
Jackie Bailey to be followed by John Mason.
Vaccination appointments for COVID boosters may be rolling out in the rest of the country, but weeks on, in mainland Argyll and Bute, there are no booster clinics at all. GPs have been giving flu vaccinations, but NHS Highland have fallen well behind in their delivery of the COVID booster. Many of my constituents, and certainly all of those over 80 years of age, have waited more than the JCVI recommended 6 months for their booster, so their protection from COVID is waning. It is critical that they receive their boosters without any further delay. So can the First Minister tell me, why is there this delay in NHS Highland? When will vaccination clinics be open locally? And when will the elderly and vulnerable in Argyll and Bute receive their COVID booster?
First Minister.
It's important that the programme continues at pace and the pace accelerates wherever possible across the whole country. I've already gone into some detail about that. I'm happy to look at the particular figures for NHS Highland and mainland Argyll and Bute in particular to see if there is a particular problem there and come back to Jackie Bailey in due course. It is important to recognise that at the point of the JCVI advice, some people, particularly in the older group, had already been waiting 6 months. We couldn't do it before we had the advice. So there has always been a catch-up requirement in this programme, and that's why it's important that we get that done as quickly as possible, and all efforts are being focused on that. But I'll come back on the particular geographic point as soon as possible.
John Mason to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you very much. I think at the start of the vaccination programme, there was a wariness from the experts and the medics about mixing vaccines for a particular person. Can the First Minister say anything about whether vaccines can be mixed now?
First Minister.
Well, all of our decisions on the vaccination programme are guided by the JCVI advice. After reviewing the data on different combinations of vaccines, the JCVI has advised that regardless of which product was used in the primary course of someone's vaccination, those who are eligible for a booster should be offered a dose of the Pfizer vaccine or a half dose of the Moderna vaccine, as these are well tolerated as a third dose and will provide strong booster protection. Where the Pfizer or Moderna vaccines can't be offered, for example, due to contraindication, booster vaccination with AstraZeneca might be considered for those who received AstraZeneca in the primary course.
Sandesh Gulhani to be followed by Annabel Ewing.
Thank you. A critical factor in our COVID recovery is NHS workforce planning, with the First Minister's own strategy looking to recruit from overseas. Across Britain, 65,000 Indian physicians currently work in the UK, and this makes up the second largest NHS cohort after those doctors trained in the UK. Given the ongoing pressures to resource our NHS here in Scotland, why are you not working with the British Association of Physicians of Indian Origin, or BAPIO, which is a recognised professional development and placement organisation that is already working within trusts in England and Wales to bring in and train doctors over 2 years through to their Royal College of Physicians membership exams, whilst providing vital services for the NHS? Will you commit to meeting and exploring the possibility of recruiting doctors via BAPIO?
First Minister.
Absolutely. I will ask the Health Secretary to look into this as a matter of urgency. I'm happy and keen that we work with anybody to try to attract people to come and work in our National Health Service. And I want to take the opportunity to express my gratitude to those who do come to Scotland to work in our Health Service, whether they come from India or any other country. They do a hugely valuable service to all of us. I know we're working with the Royal Colleges and others to try to promote and increase international recruitment right now. There is no reason that I am aware of why we wouldn't do that with any organisation seeking to help us recruit people from India. So I'm happy, as I say, to ask the Health Secretary to look into that as a matter of urgency.
Annabel Ewing to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the daily confusing picture presided over by both television and radio, which simply failed to take into account that COVID protections are very much still in place in Scotland, unlike south of the border, Can the First Minister confirm that mask wearing will still be required in Scotland for the foreseeable future, given the important role that it plays in fighting the pandemic?
First Minister.
Yes, I do envisage that the requirement to wear face coverings in certain indoor public places will remain in place for the foreseeable future. Of course, I should also say that we are required to assess that on an ongoing basis to make sure that continues to be proportionate and appropriate. But given the level of cases right now, given that we are going into the winter period, I think it is highly likely that that will continue to be a requirement for some time longer. It is, of course, one of the simplest things. It is not, of course, without inconvenience, but it is one of the simplest things we can all do to protect other people. Everybody who wears a face covering helps to protect somebody else, and that, I think, is an important part of the solidarity we all need to continue to display. So I would encourage everybody. I know it's difficult. I know we all have lapses at times in this, but all of us, I think, now should make sure that we are remembering to wear our face coverings when we are required to do so.
Julie Mackay, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I extend my party's condolences to everyone who's lost a loved one. I've previously expressed concerns about the changes to travel restrictions and the impact this will have on our ability to prevent variants from entering the country. The First Minister said in her statement that travellers who receive a positive lateral flow test will have to book a PCR test. Can the First Minister outline how this will be enforced and how this will affect our ability to monitor for new variants entering the country?
First Minister.
Well, as I said before, we are aligning on the international travel rules because of the practical considerations of having different rules in place in different parts of the UK and the potential for that to do damage to our travel industry without delivering any additional public health benefit. We have not always been in agreement with all of those changes, but we continue to discuss these things carefully with the UK government on an ongoing basis. In terms of the situation with post-arrival testing, people will still require to be tested, and the same arrangements are around that. They will simply be able to do an LFD test in the first instance, as opposed to a PCR test. And if that LFD test is positive, they will then book a PCR test in the normal way. So the requirement for testing is not being removed. It's simply the type of test in the first instance is being changed. But all of the other arrangements around the testing after people's arrival remains as it was previously.
Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Liz Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, with regard to the COVID vaccination certification scheme, can she confirm if local authorities should be ensuring that businesses across Scotland are indeed scanning the QR codes on the individual apps, or if just a visual check is acceptable?
First Minister.
Well, the NHS Scotland COVID check app is available for businesses to download, and it's free to download. This is a verifier app that businesses can use to verify vaccine certificates, and I know many businesses are using that. However, we've also made clear that visual checks are also acceptable. We continue to engage with sectors affected and will encourage more use of the app as the scheme continues to develop.
Liz Smith, to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. First Minister, you say on page 5 of your statement that it is for practical reasons that the Scottish Government has decided to make the change from a day 2 PCR test to a lateral flow test. Yet in previous statements you've said it's for medical reasons. If it is for practical reasons, is it not the case that that change could have been made at the same time that it was made for England and Wales and would have saved a lot of people a lot of problems?
First Minister.
I don't think Liz Smith, with the greatest of respect, is right when she says that I have changed the basis on which the Scottish Government is making these decisions. In terms of the change of testing, I've made clear, if it had been down to us, we may not have made all of these changes. The reason we have decided to align is because, for practical reasons, if we have different arrangements in place here, the risk is that people then simply choose to travel to Scotland via England. They then don't do what we would be requiring, so our travel industry takes a hit, but we don't have the public health benefit. That's the practical reasons I think I set out when I announced the changes previously that I have set out here today. Even so, when a change is made, it is right that we take the appropriate time to consider, in all of the circumstances, whether
that is the right thing to do to allow for those practical reasons, or whether there are any other arguments that would lead us in the opposite direction. That is what we have done. We've reached the decision I've set out today. I think it is a decision that will be welcome, but none of these decisions are easy and none of them should be taken lightly or without proper consideration.
Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Bob Dorris.
Thank you. First Minister, I'm looking for clarity around booster vaccinations and the NHS Scotland COVID status app. As residents of Uddingston and Bells Hill constituency have been in touch with me with concerns around reports that boosters will not be recorded in the NHS app and that international travel could be restricted 12 months after their second vaccination as a result. Can you provide reassurance in this matter?
First Minister. Well,
given the current state of the booster vaccination programmes, not just here in the UK but around the world, boosters are not currently required for international travel or domestic use, so they're not currently included in the COVID certification process, either the app or the non-app routes. However, we're anticipating that this may change in the future as boosters are used more widely internationally. And of course, there will be further discussions across four nations of the UK and the EU on this requirement. And of course, we'll keep Parliament appropriately updated.
Bob Dorris to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Could the First Minister provide any further update on measures being taken to encourage continued uptake of the vaccine and boosters, especially amongst young people, including the increased use of drop-in surgery, something I know my constituents in Maryhill and Springburn would very much welcome?
First Minister.
Well, the first thing to say is that uptake rates for the vaccine, for COVID vaccines, are exceptionally high across all age groups. And again, you know, I want to thank people who've come forward in such huge numbers to get their vaccination. We continue to gather information on uptake, any reasons for hesitancy, and work with health boards and other groups to try to get anyone who hasn't already come forward to take up their vaccine to consider doing so. It's important to recognise if you haven't done so already, you have not lost the opportunity and you can still come forward. Part of that consideration is thinking about the locations for vaccination. As we have gone through the bulk of the initial phase of the programme, the considerations around appointments versus drop-in clinics change because there are smaller numbers of people yet still to come forward for vaccination. As we go further into the booster programme, those considerations will change again. This is quite a dynamic programme to deliver, and it's important that we continue to learn from experience, consider the different stages we're at in the programme, and make sure that the overall arrangements are appropriate, taking account of all of that.
Pam Duncan-Clancy to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you. Throughout the pandemic, we've heard about the pressure, rightly, on the NHS. But the pressure on care services is also pushing that service and those who work in it to breaking point. Recently, this has led to some councils, like Glasgow City Council, stopping essential services and leaving pressure, more pressure on unpaid carers. Unfortunately, the COVID recovery strategy does not include specific actions to tackle the impact on unpaid carers, leaving them feeling voiceless. I've written to the Health Secretary, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care, and now the Deputy First Minister, asking them to meet with carers and hear directly about the impact. So I'd like to ask the First Minister today to set out how the government plan to support carers at this time, whether she will commit today that she or one of her ministers will meet them as soon as possible, and will she consider publishing a specific carers recovery strategy?
First Minister.
On that latter suggestion, we will certainly take that away and consider whether that would be helpful. I think I'd make a couple of points briefly. Firstly, increasingly in the way modern healthcare is delivered, we cannot distinguish between, well, we can distinguish between them, but we cannot separate the NHS and social care because the two are so closely integrated. And equally, we have to recognise very, very strongly the role of unpaid carers in the delivery of social care. And that's something that we always do. There's a range of ways in which we have been supporting unpaid carers. And one of them, for example, is the increased financial support through the carers allowance supplement. There'll be an additional payment of that coming up over the course of this winter. But I understand the pressure unpaid carers are under. This has been an incredibly difficult set of circumstances for them, so we will always consider what more we can do, and we'll certainly give consideration to the suggestion of a standalone strategy.
Karen Adam to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you. To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government is considering reintroducing shielding restrictions for people who are considered high risk over the coming winter months.
First Minister.
Well, we know how harmful shielding can be and has been to the physical and mental health of those who had to do it. So we do not want, nor do we expect, to advise a return to shielding in future. Most adults in Scotland and over 94% of adults on the highest risk list have received at least two doses of the vaccine, and many of them will be getting their booster vaccination as well. And we know that vaccine gives a significant degree of protection. So we don't want to go back to shielding. However, it is important that everybody who is in the highest risk list understands the protections they can take to make themselves safer, but that all of us recognise that in following all the mitigations we are being asked to follow, we are contributing to making the whole environment safer for those at the highest clinical risk as well.
Christine Graham to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First Minister, like Jackie Bailey, I have constituents over 80 who have yet to be offered an appointment for a booster jag, have gone beyond the 6 months, are therefore very anxious. I understand from the statement that these should be offered at the latest by early November. Is that correct?
First Minister.
Those in the over 70 age group are being vaccinated. Many of them have been vaccinated with boosters already. Those who haven't will be between now and early November. In total, over 500,000 people have had the booster vaccine, and those over 70 are being prioritised. Some of those over the age of 60, between 60 and 69, have also started to receive letters as well. I want, in all of the discussion about booster vaccinations that we've had today, which is really important discussion, I want to make very clear that while there will no doubt continue to be questions and people will push us to go faster, rightly so, there is probably no single thing and no bigger responsibility on the shoulders of government right now than to get the booster programme delivered as quickly as possible, because it is the biggest protection we will have over these winter months. I want to assure everybody across the chamber that the greatest possible priority is being given to this.
Sue Webber to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Statistics released today on the number of courses of dental treatments show that in 2020 to 2021, almost 360,000 less treatments were being carried out on children compared to the previous year, with a decrease of over 3 million treatments carried out on adults in 2021 compared to 2019-20. And this comes after warnings from dentists last week that the combination of high demand and the withdrawal of Scottish Government support will devastate the sector. Can I ask the First Minister, given this dire situation facing dentistry, what her government is going to do to ensure that dentists are supported and people can access to the vital treatment that they need? Thank you.
First Minister.
Well, obviously, the figures that the member has quoted today, which of course are a concern, are a reflection of the limitations on dental services during the course of the pandemic. It's really important that, as with other treatments, there is a catch-up as quickly as possible. We will continue to support dentists as we did pre-pandemic and as we will continue to do as we come out of this pandemic. Indeed, the Health Secretary's winter package of support, which he set out to Parliament before the recess, had funding within it for dentists, including for dental services for children. So again, we understand the importance of this, and that will be reflected in the actions that we take in the weeks and months to come.
Martin Whitfield to be followed by Emma Harper.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. Recently, the Education Secretary told this chamber that she believed that the lateral flow testing rates in schools were too low and that she would like to see higher figures. Since then, the rates have reduced again. Indeed, for S1 to S3 pupils, it's now down to 7.3%. For S4 to 6, 3.1% prior to the October week holiday. Does the First Minister believe these rates are too low? And if so, what will the First Minister and her government do to increase them?
First Minister.
Well, I want to see people take advantage of lateral flow testing. I want to see people across the population do that, and certainly young people and those who work in schools, for them that is particularly important. Testing, although we strongly, strongly recommend it, is of course voluntary, and therefore all of us, obviously led by the government, but all of us have a role to play here in encouraging people to remember to regularly test with LFD devices. It is, I think, naturally the case that when the
transmission is rising, people are perhaps more vigilant and will do it more often. When cases start to fall again, perhaps that falls away. We are, as I've said, going into a period where cases appear to be rising again, so it's an important moment for all of us to remind people of the role that regular testing can play in trying to identify cases of the virus and then be able to break the chains of transmission.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Regarding the co-administration of vaccines and booster programme, does the First Minister agree with me that it is safe to have both flu vaccine and COVID booster at the same vaccine appointment, as many other vaccines are co-administered this way, and that this co-administration will help expedite the winter flu and third dose COVID programme? And I remind Chamber that I am part of D&G's vaccination team.
First Minister.
Of course, it is entirely safe to have the COVID booster and the flu vaccine co-administered. It wouldn't be happening if that was not the clear clinical advice. And that is allowing us to make sure that both of these vaccination programmes happen as quickly as possible. I know that some people, and I've certainly had contacts to this effect, have been slightly concerned that their flu vaccine is maybe a couple of weeks later this year than it would have been in previous years because of that attempt to co-administer and not call people back twice that is underway right now. And again, as I did in my statement, I want to reassure people that given the time frame of winter flu, then the clear advice is that the timing of flu vaccinations is clinically appropriate. So I would advise people, as soon as you're invited, to come forward, and if you're offered flu and COVID in the one appointment, please make sure you take that.
And Stephen Kerr.
On the same subject, Presiding Officer, I would seek a point of clarification from the First Minister on behalf of a constituent. I note that in her statement she talked again about COVID booster and flu vaccination JAGs being co-administered. But will the First Minister confirm to the Chamber that for those who, for good reasons, want to take their flu JAGs separately from their COVID booster, that arrangements are in place for them to be dealt with separately?
First Minister.
We want everybody to get vaccinated with both COVID vaccine and with flu vaccine. So I'm not a clinician. If there is a good clinical reason or a good reason why somebody can't do that, of course we will want to facilitate that being done separately. But I would also want to take the opportunity, and I hope Stephen Kerr will assist with this, in saying to people, as Emma Harper has just highlighted, that it is clinically safe to have the vaccinations together, and our strong advice is for people to do that. That is the quickest way of getting people and getting everybody who's eligible vaccinated. So I would hope that message goes out loudly and clearly, but I also hear the message, if there are good reasons why that can't happen, we've got to facilitate the vaccines happening in other ways.
Thank you. That concludes the First Minister's statement, COVID-19 update. There'll be a brief suspension before the next item.